today's event is a little more special because apart from having Professor Rodericks, we also have the Green Voyagers. They're a bunch of enthusiastic young students who've done all the research on the forts under Professor Rodericks' guidance. So we can't wait to hear more about them, about their research, about their recommendations, and how best we can contribute to preserving the heritage of the city. So without any further delay, I invite Dr. Professor Rodericks.
Good evening, ladies and gentlemen. We are extremely honored and privileged for being given this golden opportunity to present the presentation on coastal forts of Mumbai by Observers Research Foundation. I, on behalf of Ruya College and the Green Voyagers, express deep sense of gratitude to the Observers Research Foundation, especially Dr. Leena Wadia and Mansi Papriani, who has been my student. A brief information about the Green Voyagers. This Green Voyagers is a small group of students which was established in 2011. And the basic primary interest of this particular group is working towards creating historical as well as environmental awareness about the neglected heritage of the city of Mumbai. The Exploring Coastal Forts of Mumbai is one of the pioneering projects undertaken by the students. I would like to state here that the entire project has been an eye-opener to all of us, and that none of us ever knew that so many forts existed in the city of Mumbai. Many of us had not even visited and even seen the city, these particular forts in the city of Mumbai. May I add that this particular experience of exploring these forts has been a very enriching experience, and it was extremely pleasing. And not only pleasing, I would also like to state that the students of the Green Voyagers were extremely and passionately involved in this entire research project. I see these students as budding researchers or historians in the making. Now, the structure of the presentation is, the major theme is the three-dimensional comparative study of the forts of Mumbai. The structure of the presentation is as follows. The background will be given by Dr. Luisa Rodericks, that's me. I'll be followed by Utkarsh Dandavate, who will be explaining to you all about the geopolitical as well as the historical significance of the forts of Mumbai. She'll be followed by Nandini Bhattacharya, who will be explaining to you all the ecological and environmental perspective, and then it will be concluded by Ashwini Maslekar, who will be talking about awareness and conservation strategies. Before beginning with my talk on this introduction of on the brief introduction of the city of Mumbai, I would like to begin by saying that the glorious past fascinates all of us, and many of us are very much interested in knowing our past. Mumbai city has had a rich cultural heritage and certainly a glorious past. It is indeed a multi-faceted city, and this particular city is unique because of its culture, which is unique, and environment. In fact, Mumbai city is one of the unique cities in the world, which is a rare amalgam of antiquities and modernization. When I say antiquities, one can date back to as early as 1st century BC when the Kanheri Caves was constructed by the Satavahana dynasty. Today, Mumbai is undergoing rapid metamorphosis with increasing towers and innovations in architecture. And yet, you find that the icons in Mumbai do remain as a historical landmark. I would like to emphasize over here, the city certainly needs to ensure to preserve these icons, which is of intrinsic importance, and to build up this historicity of Mumbai. It is also very essential to maintain a balance, in fact, a very critical balance between heritage and modernity, and to ensure that one realm does not obviate and eliminate the other. For instance, in the wake of modernization, so many development projects being taken up, we do see a serious threat to the existing existing heritage structures, especially the forts which are in a dilapidated state. Mumbai city, if you see, one of the major icons are the forts in Mumbai. These forts have played a very important role in the cosmopolitan city of, shaping the cosmopolitan city of Mumbai. And what we see is that these forts were built, around 11 forts were built in the city of Mumbai. Our presentation basically, the scope of a presentation basically will be limited only to the city Mumbai, that is up to Sion and Bandra. So we will be concentrating only on 9 forts, and one of the most ancient fort which was constructed was in the 12th century AD, in 1140 by Bhim Deva, and it was constructed at Mahim. You find that Mumbai has Mumbai was always susceptible to attacks, and so when the colonial powers colonized Mumbai, beginning from the Portuguese rule to the British rule, they realized the relevance and importance of constructing forts. Forts were constructed in Mumbai, most of them being constructed by the British, and this was basically for the purpose of defense, for the purpose of trades, to have control over the ports, as well as to control also the sea traffic. Well, these forts certainly are the repositories and treasure trove of the city of Mumbai. And in this, it was really painful to see that so many of the forts are in a dilapidated state, are almost in ruins, and on the brink of almost extinction. So we really feel that any structure, if it gets demolished, a heavy price is paid. With the loss of structure, the memories in it are also lost. I would like to quote over here John Ruskin, the 19th century philosopher, who aptly puts in, "We may live without architecture, we may worship without her, but we may not remember without her." So the forts certainly are a part of heritage. It needs to be, a serious attention need to be paid to it, to preserve, to conserve it, not only for today, but for posterity. I now call upon Utkarsh Dandavate, who will be addressing the audience about the geopolitical significance and the historical aspects of Mumbai. Thank you.
The city of Mumbai as we know it today would have only been a distant dream without the presence of the forts of Mumbai. This aspect becomes very clear after we take a look at the historical and political significance of the forts of Mumbai. To help us with this aspect, I'll be referring to this map of the 7 islands of Mumbai, which originally were unclaimed from the sea. And I will take the look of a teacher over here and point out to you the 7 islands of Mumbai. Beginning from the southernmost tip, we have the Colaba Fort, followed by the Old Woman's Island, the Bombay Fort, where the southern Mumbai is located presently, the Mazgaon Fort, the Mazgaon Island, the Parel Island, Varli, and Mahim. This over here is the Salsette Island, which is covered by the suburbs of Bombay, and it was not a British possession earlier. It was possessed first by the Portuguese and then the Marathas, which made it very important for the British to protect their holdings in the Bombay Islands. Before Bombay, Surat was the most important trade center on the western coast. But the increasingly hostile policy of the Mughals, as well as repeated attacks of Marathas, forced the European powers in Surat to find a safer haven on the western coast. And Bombay presented a fair opportunity. Portuguese acquired the Bombay, Bassein, and Salsette Islands in 1534 from the governor of Gujarat. Excuse me. The islands of Bombay were transferred to the British in a marital contract of the Catherine of Braganza and Prince Charles II of England in 1661. But it was not until 1665 that the British finally got hold of the islands. And even then, the Portuguese were extremely reluctant to let go of the very fertile region of Bombay, which was harboring their trade interest. Which is why the relations between the Portuguese and British were permanently soured, and this made it important for the British to protect their islands from any future Portuguese attacks. In such a political environment, where the British were constantly threatened by rival powers of the Portuguese, Dutch and Marathas, they needed to fortify their holdings, and here we see is a map of the location of all the forts, and I would like to explain to you why the forts are located where they are located. Beginning from the southernmost tip, we see Bombay Fort, which is currently not in a... we cannot see the fort walls of the Bombay Fort, whereas the manor house is located in the naval dockyard area, and it was where the town or the city of Bombay took birth. So it was an important trade outpost, and it was the seat of the Bombay Presidency government, which was why they needed to fortify the island. And from 1675 onwards, we see that the fortification begins, and over a century, a strong wall, strong impermeable wall is built around the Bombay Castle. On the eastern coast of Bombay, we see the building of Siudi and Masgaon Fort. Siudi and Masgaon were mainly important to protect the Bombay Islands from any attack from eastern Konkan area. The Siddhis of Janjira. Janjira, as we know, is located in northern Konkan border, and it is proximal to the eastern coast of Bombay, which is why Siudi and Masgaon Fort helped to keep a watch on the northern Konkan border. Towards the northern side, number 4 and 5 are the Dharavi and Sion forts. Mahim Creek, as we know it today, is an effect of reclamation of the sea. The crescent-shaped creek is what we see is the present-day Mahim Creek. But earlier, before the reclamation, the creek extended even beyond the Mahim Causeway. And where we see is Dharavi and Sion Fort were in fact coastal forts before the reclamation, which is why Dharavi and Sion were important watchtowers to keep a look on the northern border of the Bombay Islands. In fact, Sion is located at the northernmost tip of Bombay, and it made it the official boundary of the Portuguese possessions and British possessions. On the left-hand side, Mahim, Bandra and Worli forts were instrumental in controlling the Mahim area, Mahim Creek, because attacks from sea were extremely common since southern tip of Bombay was unnavigable, and this gave an encouragement for attackers to enter from eastern and western coast. We need to understand that before the 19th century, the forts of Bombay were the only high-rises and skyscrapers of the islands of Bombay, which is why coast-to-coast and fort-to-fort communication was possible. The forts were structured in a way to give them a panoramic view of the sea, and this made it possible, even today, standing at the tip of the Salsette Island, that is what we know as Bandra today, we can nearly look at the tip of the Worli Island. So, despite the development of the island, we can still see that forts had their significance, and we can almost relive the past at the Land's End of Mumbai. Coming to the history of all these forts, I will quickly give a brief introduction to the history without going into many technical details. On the left-hand side, we see is the entrance of the Bombay Castle. Bombay Castle or Manor House was built in 1675 by the Portuguese, and it was the seat of the governor of Bombay. This was seat of the government, yet when the British possessed the islands in 1655, they realized that it was extremely ill-protected, and since the British were constantly threatened by sea attacks, Sir Gerald Ongar, who was the governor of Bombay and Surat, felt the need of extended fortifications, and the Bombay Fort Wall, which is non-existent today, was built around the fort area. Of the Bombay Fort, only the Bombay Castle remains, which is protected by the Naval Dockyard, and it is open for visitors, so for civilians, on the first Sunday of every month. And I hope after this presentation, many of us can take a chance and visit the Bombay Castle, as it is an extremely well-protected monument. On the right side is the wall of the fort of St. George. St. George Fort was only an extension on the northern end of the Bombay Fort. Now, St. George Fort was the result of the complex geopolitical circumstances of the 18th century. At the height of the Anglo-French War, the British were constantly threatened by a French attack on their Indian possessions. And St. George Fort was built where Dongri Fort was located. Dongri Fort was an earlier Portuguese fort. It was demolished since it was extremely close to Bombay. And in its place, St. George Fort was built. And it was a contingency plan. If the French had attacked Bombay, and if the Bombay Fort had failed, the Europeans in the Bombay Fort were to escape, enter St. George through the church gate, and from there they were to take a ferry or a boat to go to Thane and Kalyan to seek protection from the Marathas. So this complex diplomatic network is what gave St. George Fort its importance. Post the Anglo-French War, the threat of the attack faded, the attack never really happened. And Sir Bartle Frere realized that this structure can be converted to something that can be used in the current environment, socio-economic life of Bombay, and it was converted to a hospital. St. George Hospital still survives, and many of us can see this wall of the Bombay Fort still existing. Coming to the eastern coast of Bombay, as we've seen that it was extremely prone to be attacked or vulnerable to attacks from Siddi Yaqut Khan, who was based in Northern Konkan. And Siudi Fort was built in 1680 exactly for the reason of protecting the Bombay Islands from an attack from that side. And it narrowly escaped complete destruction at his hands. Fortunately, it was renovated immediately the next year because of its strategic importance. And for a brief period, it was even used as a prison by the British. But there was a major prison break, which made the British realize that it cannot be used as a prison, after which it was continued to be used as a go-down. Post-independence, the Siudi Fort was used as a go-down by the Bombay Port Trust. Now, the Bombay Port Trust even forwarded a plea to the government to demolish the Siudi Fort and use the land to develop quarters for their workers. Fortunately for you and me, the fort was protected from such a misfortune, and in 2008, the fort was restored to almost resemble its previous glory. Masgaon Fort remains only in memory. What we see here is the picture of the Masgaon Garden, the Joseph Baptista Garden, which is built in its place, because it was demolished the very next year it was constructed. Like Siudi Fort, it was constructed to protect the Bombay Islands from the attack of Siddi Yaqut Khan. But Siddi Yaqut Khan was nearly the villain of the Bombay for that age. He destroyed the Masgaon Fort in his second attempt. And the British realized that since the size of the Masgaon Fort is huge, it was second only to the Bombay Fort in its size. And fresh from the losses of the war, the British thought it would be much more convenient to build something else in its place. In 1884, a water tank and the garden that we see today was built in the place of the Masgaon Fort. Now it is important to know that Masgaon Fort is an excellent example of how paralyzed and dilapidated government structures can be released to be used as public spaces. And we can definitely learn a thing or two from the British. Dharavi Fort was built in 1737 by the British to keep a check on the Mahim Creek, the extended Mahim Creek, the unreclaimed Mahim Creek. And the architecture of Dharavi Fort is extremely peculiar. It is one of the few forts which has absolute lack of any civic comfort. It has got no residential quarters. In fact, the entrance, it doesn't even actually have a real entrance. The way to go to the fort is to get a ladder to reach the rooftop from where the soldiers would keep a watch on the northern boundary of the fort. And in fact, this specific feature of the architecture is what protects it from direct encroachment even today. Although the fort is in ruins, we do not see any direct inhabitation within the confines of the fort. Sion Fort was very proximal to Dharavi Fort, and the added advantage that Sion Fort had was its height. Sion is based on a hillock, it is built on a hillock, and this gave it an added advantage. It gave it an upper hand over the enemy, as it could see. Even today, when you go to the Sion Fort and you stand on the hillock, you can get a panoramic view for the perimeter of the view is very large, despite the high rises of the present era. Now, Sion is a Portuguese corruption of the Marathi term Shiv. Shiv literally means a boundary. And Sion, based at the northernmost tip of the Bombay Islands, was an important possession for the British, and they have used it to its fullest. And Sion Fort was one of the few forts to actually have residential quarters, although those quarters which are based on the hillock which we see over here are in absolute ruins, and it is very difficult to make out for a layman of what the original structure was. At the base of the hillock is a garden, the Jawaharlal Nehru Garden that we know today was the military base for training the soldiers who guarded the Sion Fort. Mahim Fort is an extraordinary example in every sense. It is the oldest surviving fort in Mumbai. It was built in 1140 by Pratap Bhim, and it was Mahim was the ancient capital of Mahikavati, which was a holding of the Bhim dynasty in the ancient period, and it was in fact built by them. And the thriving, since Mahim was an important trade center, the thriving trade in the region was what made it an attractive location, attractive holding for every naval power. Time and again, the Portuguese, first the Arabs, and then the Portuguese, Dutch, and British have tried to acquire the Mahim Fort. The British were finally successful, and they used it to the fullest up till the 19th century to keep a view on the Mahim Creek. Even today, Mahim Fort is directly commands a view of the Bandravali ceiling, and one can imagine why the location is as important from military as well as trade point of view. In the ring of protecting the Mahim Creek, the second fort is Worli Fort. As if you can remember the shape of the Mahim Creek, which is a crescent shape, Mahim was located at the center of the crescent or the sea. Worli was at the bottom. It was at the northernmost tip of the Worli Island, and Bandra was at the northernmost tip. So together, Worli, Bandra and Mahim protected the Mahim Creek from any piratical activities as well as any military activities. So all the forts were important from trade as well as military point of view. Worli Fort, as we can see from the photo, is the architecture is nearly resembling what could have been the original built of the fort. The base of the fort is very broad, and it's a tapering structure. So it makes it very difficult for soldiers to climb up the fort. And the fort itself is based on a height. So it gives a very added advantage to the soldiers who are protecting from the Worli Fort. And it was, time and again, it was upgraded to the military capacity, the arms capacity of the fort was upgraded all the time to keep it in the advantageous position. Coming to the Bandra Fort is easily the easiest, easily the most popular forts of Mumbai. Most of us have visited Bandra Fort as we went for a ride to the Bandra Bandstand or have been taking a nice walk along Mannat. And Bandra Fort, as located at the southernmost tip of Salsette Island, was the only possession that the British acquired on the Salsette Island, which was owned by the Portuguese. So it made it extremely important not only to keep a control on the Mahim Creek, but also to acquire an advantage on the Salsette Island, which was an enemy territory. The Bandra Fort was demolished in 1739 by the Portuguese when they finally acquired the fort, as they were constantly under the threat of a Maratha attack. And in the up till 18th century, 19th century, forts had a two-way purpose. One was to protect their own territory. Second was to let the enemy know that this is my territory. So Bandra Fort was a way of the British telling the Portuguese that this is our territory, and it is activities of any suspicious nature will be registered by the British from the Bandra Fort. The fort itself was demolished in 1739, but the renowned philanthropist and businessman Jamsetji Jijibhai restored the fort nearly to its previous glory in 1850. But it was mainly a recreational, public recreational space instead of a historical space. Later, it was renovated, restored by P.K. Das and Associates. Yet, we cannot see the entire structure of the fort, and we can only imagine what the location, what view the location of the fort might have commanded. Armed with this brief history of the forts, we can easily highlight a few important uses of these forts. Arguably, the most important use of a fort can be as a watchtower, and all the forts of Mumbai have served this purpose very successfully. The crescent-shaped creek that Mahim is today was protected by the three forts of Bandra in the north, Worli in the south, and Mahim in the east. So this strategic location made it important that these forts were armed at all the times, and we see that the architecture today can still show the traces of any preparation for any combat if it were to occur. The forts were also used as centers of trade. Now Mahim was already an important trade center in the medieval time, but its importance decreased as Bombay was rising in importance. And later on in the 19th century, we see that the Bombay Fort was the most important location for the cotton and opium trade. In fact, the courtyard outside the Bombay Castle, the Bombay Green, was a location where the surplus of cotton was stored, and hands-on trading of cotton was taking place. Forts were also occasionally used as storehouses if the architecture and if they had the infrastructure available for it. Siudi Fort was used as a storehouse by the British as a go-down of its trade surplus, and post-independence it was used by the Bombay Port Trust. In fact, the Bombay Castle even today serves as a storehouse of naval troop supplies. Although in Bombay, the most important function that a fort has served has been to house the wonderful town of Bombay. The fort, the Bombay, young Bombay town, took birth within the confines of the wall, and without the presence of the wall, it would have been impossible to protect this trade center of the British. And the forts became all the more important, as we see that during the course of the history, there were repeated attacks on the fort, but the Bombay fort has managed to survive these attacks, and what we see today is the effect of this forts. As the British were trying to establish their supremacy over the Indian subcontinent, these forts served of invaluable assistance. Although once they had secured their position, they gradually faded out of public memory. These are the structures that we conveniently forgot in our race of urbanization. I call upon Nandini to bring us back to present and tell us about how these forts exist in present-day Mumbai. Thanks a lot.
Good evening, ladies and gentlemen. I'll be talking to you about the current state of the forts in Mumbai, of Mumbai in the 21st century. First of all, I'd like to tell you that for the purpose of this presentation, we can classify the forts into two categories. Basically, those which are well preserved and those which are not. So, the forts which are well preserved, according to us, will be Bandra, Worli, Siuri, and Bombay Castle. And the ones which are not well preserved will be Dharavi, Mahim, and Sion. Let's talk about Bandra Fort. Bandra Fort was restored by P.K. Das and Associates under a directive of the Archaeological Survey of India in 2004. The restoration work was fairly up to the mark. Currently, Bandra Fort is being taken care of by the Bandra Bandstands Residence Trust, and the job that they do is commendable. The fort itself is being preserved as well as it can be, and unlawful activities like loitering and littering unlawfully is at a minimum. Now, Bandra Fort, as we just heard, is a very popular tourist spot. It is located in the suburb of Bandra, and there are hordes of tourists, college students, and basically just the locals of the entire suburbs, they congregate here. So Bandra Fort can be said that is extremely in the minds of Mumbaikars. So then, let us take a look at Siuri Fort. Siuri Fort was also restored in 2008 by the Maharashtra state government under the Mumbai Fort Circuit project. The restoration of Siuri Fort leaves something to be desired because some of the walls were torn down and some walls were constructed where they were not previously. So the original architecture is lost to some extent. At the same time, Siuri Fort, we know, is a hub of ecotourism because every year a migratory bird, the pink urban flamingos or the lesser flamingos, they arrive every year around late October, early November, and this is why probably Siuri Fort has survived in public memory as well as it has. Next, let's take a look at Bombay Castle and Worli Fort. The Western Naval Command High Quarters are in INS Angre, and the INS Angre is therefore entrusted with the job of taking care of Bombay Castle and other significant historical buildings in the area. This is a job that the INS Angre has done commendably. Not a lot of the Bombay Castle remains, and this is only natural because it is an old uninhabited structure and what remains of it is well preserved. Similarly, Worli Fort was restored late 2008-2009. The problem with Worli Fort is that the restoration job was not exactly up to the mark. It is hidden under coats and coats of cement concrete, and the original architecture does not shine through. We can almost say that what remains at Worli Fort is just an imitation of the fort itself. It's present in the site of the ruins, but they're not the ruins of the fort at all. At the same time, what remains in Worli Fort is extremely well kept. There is a local citizens initiative which takes care of Worli Fort extremely well. There is no loitering, littering on the premises at all, and therefore it is well preserved. Now, the forts which are not well preserved, namely Mahim, Dharavi, and Sion. Mahim, Dharavi, and Sion forts. Alright, so let's look at the first fort. Mahim Fort was the first fort to be built in Bombay. The fort is extremely sadly encroached upon. The encroachment is out of limits over there. Therefore, the original structure is completely lost under the encroachments. The physical there is no physical maintenance of the fort whatsoever. And you can say that the fort will crumble eventually if this state of affairs continue. Next, let's look at Dharavi Fort. Now, Dharavi Fort, what exists over there is the Kala Kila region. The original walls of the fort are far beyond what other ruins are. So as soon as you enter, it is the perimeter of the original wall. The walls of Kala Kila still stand. And as soon as you enter through these walls, you can see the slums or the shanties of Dharavi. Now, it is surprising, but the streets of Dharavi are actually quite clean. this sense of hygiene, unfortunately, does not extend up to the ruins themselves. The ruins are in a shambling state. The walls are crumbling. There is no way of actually accessing the inner sanctum of the fort because there is a lot of garbage. The locals misuse this fort entirely, and we can say that the forts are in a terrible condition. Now, what is most surprising is that Sion Fort is not really well preserved. Sion Fort was also restored. It houses one of the two offices of the Archaeological Survey of Mumbai, of India, of course, in Mumbai. And it is for this reason that it is ironic that the fort itself is not that well preserved. For the purpose of this presentation, can we say that there are two parts of Sion Fort. Sion Fort is built on a hillock, and we can say there is a lower structure and an upper structure. So the lower structure is entirely demolished. It has made way for the Jawaharlal Nehru Public Garden and Library. The usage of the fort in this way is commendable, but the lower structure no longer exists. What we see here is the upper structure. And as you can see, the walls are crumbling. Nature is literally reclaiming this spot. The walls are crumbling. The stairs are treacherous. We do not advise anyone go alone, especially in the monsoons, because the structure itself is extremely unsafe. Next, we can look at the environmental and the ecological aspects of the forts of Mumbai. Once again, if you go to see Bombay Castle and Worli Fort, fare the best in this area. That is the reason for this is simple, because Bombay Castle is taken care of by the INS Angre. They have done a commendable job of it. There is no littering, there is no loitering, and the area itself is extremely well kept. Of course, as I mentioned before, the walls are crumbling, and of course, since this is a natural phenomenon, you can't really help it unless we desire to undertake another wave of restoration for the Bombay Castle. Worli Fort, similarly, is well kept because of the local citizens' initiative. The residents of the little fishing village where Worli Fort is currently, where you can find Worli Fort, they have taken it upon themselves to take care of the fort. They use the fort as a public property. There is a small mandir, and they use the fort itself as a small local gymkhana, and which is why the upkeep of the Worli Fort is extremely, extremely good. Next, we can take a look at Bandra Fort. Now, as I said before, Bandra Bandstand's Residence Trust is taking care of Bandra Fort, which is why on the fort itself, there is not that much litter or garbage. However, the walls are completely defaced. The reason for this is simple. It is visited by students and tourists every day, and in India, that is a very common thing for almost every monument. So, as I said, the walls themselves are defaced. Another thing is that Bandra Fort is right on the seafront. And the seafront is not as well maintained as Bandra Fort. There is a lot of litter, there is a lot of garbage. You can find empty liquor bottles and things of that sort. When looking at the ecological aspect of Bandra Fort, a new development on that front is the construction of the Bandra Worli Sea Link. The way the Bandra Worli Sea Link has been constructed is such that it literally pushes the waves towards the bottom of the Bandra Fort walls, which are in the sea. This is contributing to the erosion of the walls. It is a serious problem that needs to be taken care of immediately, or we may have to again face the prospect of losing Bandra Fort entirely. Next, we can take a look at Sion Fort. Sion Fort again, I'm just going to say, the walls are defaced. There is quite a lot of garbage in the fort itself. The walls are defaced. And as you can see, the nature is literally reclaiming the fort. There are wild bushes, creepers, there are trees growing through some of the walls, so this situation needs to be addressed. Siuri Fort is a center of activity. It is situated right next to a school and a dargah, which is why there are always hordes of students present over there. This state of affairs has contributed to Siri Fort being defaced in every way possible. There are mounds of garbage on the floor. The floors are hidden under mounds of garbage. The walls are defaced and it is filthy. Siri Fort, of course, has an ecological aspect, and that is of the pink urban flamingos. The lesser flamingos, they arrive in Mumbai every year, late October, early November. Their breeding cycle takes place on the mud flats of Siri Creek. It is because of this reason that Siri Fort provides a perfect vantage spot to observe this natural phenomenon. And it is our view that we can make use of this phenomenon to make it an ecotourism hub. This will require an entire overhaul of the existing infrastructure. But if it does happen, we can completely estimate the kind of benefits it will have. Finally, we have to talk about Mahim and Dharavi. Mahim and Dharavi are completely encroached upon. There is no aspect of Mahim or Dharavi that is not covered in garbage and litter. In Dharavi in particular, because it is a slum area, people over there use the fort for many antisocial purposes. And they use it as a public lavatory. They use it to house their livestock. It is similar in Mahim, where people have made their home in the fort itself. Many of the forts in Mumbai do not possess a clear ecological perspective because they are right in the center of the city, and urbanization has robbed them of many of the ecological unique points that they may have had. The forts that we can talk about that still possess some ecological perspectives are Mahim, Bandra, Worli, and Siuri, because they are still on the creek, and this lends them some ecological advantage. This brings us to encroachment. Encroachment is the biggest problem in Mahim Fort. Mahim Fort, as you can see, is completely encroached upon. The fort possesses extremely strong outer fortifications, and small lesser structures within the fort use these strong outer fortifications as a support structure to build their own homes in. There was a cylindrical exit to the original fort, which has now been converted into a passageway to the fort. As soon as you enter the fort from this passageway, what you notice is three-story structures throughout the fort. The fort itself is not visible because of these. It is our estimate that approximately 200 families live within Mahim Fort. This is a conservative estimate, we believe, and you can understand the kind of encroachment this fort is undergoing. This is not a new state of affairs because you can see the borewells and the hand pumps within the fort. So you know that this state of affairs has been going on for a very long time. And it takes a lot of action to consider what can be done about Mahim Fort. It cannot be continued like this. Then we can take a look at the antisocial activities that occur on most of these forts. As you can probably imagine, these forts are not being visited very frequently. Smoking, drinking, gambling are some of the antisocial activities that occur here frequently, almost all the time. After sunset, most of these forts turn into congregation points for gangs of men to just use these forts as they will. This gives the forts a very unsavory reputation, and we need to get rid of this unsavory reputation if we want to make use of the forts in today's context. Siuri, Dharavi, and Mahim forts in particular are extremely plagued because of this. Bandra and Sion forts also, you can say, are ill-used because they are not really kept as well as they should be. There is a slight element of littering and you know, using this, these places as trysting points for people to meet. And we became, on our visits to the forts, we became quite used to the sight of liquor bottles, plastics, wrappers, and other such litter all over the place. So it is our conjecture that since there is no security in this, in these areas, the forts, there is no deterrent for the locals to act responsibly. This in turn encourages the locals to misuse the forts as they will. This has not always been the case. In fact, we know that most of the forts are being used in some or the other capacity. Let's take a look at the way the forts are being used now. There is some hope left for most of the forts. For example, Siuri. Like I mentioned before, Siuri is a hub of ecotourism within the city. The pink urban flamingos that congregate here every year have made sure that Siuri is not forgotten entirely. If we can arrange for a proper settled manner for these phenomenon to be observed, I believe that we can make use of Siuri Fort and the other forts situated on the creek in some manner. So ecotourism is one thing that a lot of forts probably can be used for. Gardens and public places. Like I told you, the lower structure of Sion Fort now exists only as Jawaharlal Nehru Public Garden and Library. It is a very popular spot because of all the college students who go there, and it's famous with the locals themselves. Similarly, at the spot where Masgaon Fort earlier stood, it is now Joseph Baptista Garden, and it's a very popular spot as well. Within Bandra Fort itself, there are a few nurseries which exist within the perimeters of the walls. So this is how the forts can be used in a very legal and environment-friendly way. Finally, we come to the cultural events that can take place in the forts. At present, only Bandra Fort is being used in this manner. Bandra Fort, as I told you, is a very popular place in Mumbai. Recently, there was an Indian Ocean concert over there. There are many events taking, college events taking place over there. Art exhibitions are held there. Events under the initiative of Aman Ki Asha took place there. So we know that these places can be used in this manner. Similarly, the INS Angre permits citizens to visit Bombay Castle on the first Sunday of every month. Can this be done for the other forts if there were facilities available? We have to try. And so I call Ashwini to talk to us about what we can do to improve the situation and what we must do to improve the situation. Thank you.
As Nandini talked to us about the social, cultural, and political importance and the usage of these forts in the 21st century, we might have noticed that forts like Bandra, Siuri, and Sion are quite well known. I mean, but that is confined to their locality. If you go and ask people in Worli, they probably might not know about the Sion Fort, but Bandra is an exception. Everybody knows it. So what can be done is to promote all these forts collectively. There are six forts still existing in Mumbai. If all these forts are promoted under the banner of Forts of Mumbai, it'll be beneficial to everybody, the tourists, the tourism ministry, and to the forts, of course. She just gave an example about the Indian Ocean concerts that are held in the Bandra Fort Amphitheater. How many people coming for those concerts would know that there's a fort actually existing to the place where they're sitting? People coming to Siuri, they are on the fort watching the flamingos, but how many of them are appreciating the fort that they're standing on? How many of them know the history of that fort? Not many, I'll tell you. This is the reality. Even we did not know about all these forts. So to promote these forts collectively, the government and the citizens must come together. No, there is no responsibility. The responsibility should not be put on one person or one authority. And anyways, all these forts are not under one authority. The Bandra Fort is maintained by the Bandra Bandstand's Residence Trust. Sion Fort comes under the jurisdiction of the Archaeological Survey of India. Bombay Castle is maintained by the Naval Dockyard. And while the other forts of Mumbai are under the Maharashtra State Department of Archaeology. Even though they are under different authorities, nobody's stopping them to come together and form one framework with the same aim of conserving these forts. That is what we want. So if all these authorities have one framework under them, they can work towards this collectively. As these two talked to us about the restoration projects that are being done on these forts, let's talk a little about that. Siuri, Worli, Bandra have been restored. But what has happened in case of Worli and Siuri is that they have, in the process of restoration, kind of lost their historical look, especially Siuri. The whole essence of its heritage has been lost under the coats and coats of cement that has been put. Just because they were told to restore this fort, it doesn't mean that they should hamper or harm the heritage. The authorities must keep in mind that while they are conserving a fort, it is their aim to protect and preserve the heritage, the history of the fort. These forts remain mere shadows of their original self. We should not let that happen. That needs to be prevented. And after these forts have been constructed, they eventually go back to the same path of neglect because nobody talks about it, nobody knows that this kind of projects have been undertaken. This way, we as students and citizens of Mumbai have some small suggestions which can be taken up. And since we have to, and all these suggestions are interlinked. One leads to another, and if one is missed out, there will be something left out throughout the whole conservation project. The first thing to do would be to include all the forts in conservation projects. There are forts like Mahim, Dharavi, and Sion, which have never been touched. They lie sadly in bad state. They are in ruins. Dharavi needs the most recognition. It is the most ignored fort of all. And then it has a lot of potential. So the government needs to include all the forts that are there in Mumbai in their projects if they further take up such issues in their coming years. Since we have to begin from somewhere, I talked about it being interlinked, let us begin from the most important thing that can be done from the government and the citizens' side, increasing awareness. If the government has taken initiative of beginning the conservation work, beginning the restoration work, they should let the citizens know that they are doing such a thing. If the citizens are not aware that the government has taken the first step, they themselves will not feel anything towards it. After the government makes sure that the citizens know about what they're doing, they will themselves feel the need to go and visit. They will feel, okay, this is something new. We didn't know there was a fort like this. Let us go and visit. The government has restored it. Let us go and visit and see how they have done the work. This can be effectively done because nowadays we have a lot of print and social media. Social media especially. People talk a lot there. So why not spread the news that such and such project is going on? Why don't the students, you know, talk about it. Oh, I've been to Siuri Fort. It is a good place. Go and visit. This way the news will spread. If the news spreads, there will be more and more awareness created. And if there is more awareness, there will be valuable responsiveness from the citizens also. The government cannot leave the responsibility after they are done up the fort. They should make sure that their work is known to the citizens. So that will be the first step in conserving the forts and letting the people know that such and such things can be done. Another way that we can set in motion the process of all production of these forts would be to maintain cleanliness. If the forts are dirty, if there is garbage all around, no one would want to go there. Even if there is awareness, people will just say, no, it's too dirty, I am not going there, I cannot handle the dirt. So to make the forts welcoming for the tourists, it must be well maintained. Installation of dustbins, regulations, fines for littering, fines for defacing the fort walls, all this has been done by the government, if not in the required sense, but then yes, they have some laws. But unless there is self-supervision, unless we as tourists say that no, I am not going to litter here, this is a heritage structure, I will find a dustbin, even if it's not there, I will go and throw it in my home. Even small things like that, individual initiatives will help and reduce the garbage that has been already accumulated in these areas. So for cleanliness, there are two aspects. First, do not litter, and second, clean up the mess that has been created. So to not litter is again an individual responsibility. The government will just make laws. You have to follow them. To clean up the mess, Nowadays, we see a lot of citizens' initiatives like cleanup drives. We've read in newspapers that students in schools and colleges go to the beaches of Mumbai to clean up, and then they spread awareness that the beaches should be cleaned regularly and things like that. If the focus of such cleanup drives also includes these forts, it can actually serve a dual purpose of maintaining these forts and making the citizens and the students knowledgeable about them. If they personally go there and if they personally see what kind of state these forts are lying in, they will feel something towards it. So this will again set in motion the chain of awareness, cleanliness, tourism, and such and such.